Good morning, First Baptist Church. How is everybody?
Good morning.
Well, good. We are so glad that you're here to worship with us. And let me give you some updates. So when you look around and you see Johnny and I wandering in circles, you'll know why. Brian is at home and doing very well. He should be back in the office hopefully tomorrow or Tuesday. He is probably watching this online, which when he comes back, that means Johnny and I have to get back to work and stop playing games all day. But him and Christy are doing very well. I talked to him several times through the weekend. So I also want to let you know that at the end of this week, Micah has tested positive. So being praying for Micah and Amy as they are at home, they're doing okay. I talked to them yesterday also. And I want to let you know, Ginger is on vacation because I didn't want you to think that everybody's gone or at home locked in their rooms. So they are visiting their, I told somebody this morning they're visiting their kids, and I was like, no, they're not. They're visiting their grandkids. They're not seeing their kids. The kids are there, but they're visiting the grandkids. So they are having a very restful time away. And so we are so glad that you're here to worship with us today. Today preaching, you are honored and get the privilege of hearing Brent Rimple. And I'm going to read this right here because I didn't have time to memorize it. But Brent is one of our newest staff members down at Stark College and Seminary. He is the director of graduate programs, and he is a lector in theology. And you can see the rest of his bio here. He has a wonderful wife and kids. Brent has just come to Corpus, so I know that you guys will be nice to him today and give him a wonderful Corpus welcome as he comes in and has joined the staff here in July. You could not have picked a hotter time to move to Corpus Christi, Texas, Brent. So, yeah. So, if you're visiting with us, hope that you will take time to fill out the card in front of you in the pew and place it in the offering plate as it comes by later in our service. But as we start today, we're going to join in prayer. And I do want to tell you at the end of the service, I have a video from Brian. And so I know some of you sneak out sometimes to run to get ready for Bible study, but he has a message he wants to relay to you. So don't run out of here at the end of the service. You're not going to want to miss that. So. But join me in prayer. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity we have to be here today, Lord. I thank you that we have an opportunity as a family to come before you today and lift up our voices and give you the praise that you deserve, Lord. Lord, today as Brent comes and shares from his heart the message that you've laid on it, Lord, I ask that you will speak through him, that you will use him in a mighty way. Lord, that we will be able to clear our minds and focus on you and hear from you today. Lord, for Brian and Christy and Mike and Amy at home, that you continue to watch over them, that you keep them safe, and Lord, be the great physician that you are. Lord, for Ginger and Keith, is there a way, and just giving them a time of relaxation, enjoying family and their grandkids, Lord, that you bring them back safely, Lord. Lord, once again, we are so grateful for a time that we come before you as a family today to worship and lift up our voices and open your word, Lord. It's in your wonderful name that we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Amen. We have come this morning to proclaim Christ and to worship together our Savior. Let's stand together as we sing this morning and as we begin to give praise to God be the glory.
My deep and bound. Yeah. Will you pray with me?
Heavenly Father, we praise your holy name. We thank you in this time of uncertainty, knowing that you always, always have our best interests in mind. We ask that you bless this collection, and we bless the congregation here today. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Everybody hear me? Good morning. You know, I was asked the other day to pray in Canadian, and I, as a joke, of course, I grew up in Canada, and I did not know how to respond, and I think the person asking me to pray in Canadian, they were trying to put me on the spot and try to perhaps embarrass me, and so I said, you know, I say, well, in my mind, I'm like, well, we all pray to the same God. We all pray in roughly the same way. But at the end of my prayer, I just said, amen. And I thought that emphasis kind of drove home the point, and that was all I knew how to do. And so I'm blessed to be here this morning. My name is Brent Rempel. I am the new director of graduate programs at Stark College and Seminary. I moved here, I guess it would be about six weeks ago now, with my family. So I'm married to my wife, Rebecca. We have three young kids. Aged 5 to 8 years old. And so I am a busy dad, and I love it. So this morning, Our text is going to be Psalm 78. So if you have your Bibles, you could turn there with me now. And before I read our passage, if you would, just let me pray. Blessed Lord, this morning we confess your praiseworthy deeds. Lord, we know that you are the God who delivered the Israelites from Egypt, from their bondage. And God, on the cross of Calvary, you delivered us from the bondage of sin. And this morning I pray, Lord, that you by your Spirit would come and would guide our thoughts, that you would convict, that you would comfort, and that your name would be praised and glorified. I pray all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. So read with me from Psalm 78, verses 1 through 8. My people, hear my teaching. Listen to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth with a parable. I will utter hidden things, things of old, things we have heard and known, things our ancestors have told us. We will not hide them from their descendants. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power and the wonders he has done. He decreed statutes for Jacob and established the law in Israel, which he commanded our ancestors to teach their children, so the next generation would know them, even the children yet born. And they in turn would tell their children. Then they would put their trust in God and would not forget his deeds, but would keep his commands. They would not be like their ancestors, a stubborn and rebellious generation, whose hearts were not loyal to God, whose spirits were not faithful to him. God's faithfulness supplies our faithfulness. God's faithfulness supplies, inspires our faithfulness to God. See, stories or narratives or histories, they create our identity. What do I mean by that? I just mean that a story or a history, something that we tell to ourselves, something that we tell to our children, those things are forming of who we are, of what we do, of how we act. Right? And so as we look at this psalm, what I want us to think about is how the history of Israel, the history of God's faithfulness to his people, inspired and motivated and supplied their faithfulness to God. You see, I think that we know this to be true, that stories create our identity. I think we do. I think about it in big ways and in small ways, right? Think about something small and seemingly inconsequential, like a sports team that your family is just committed to, you know? And so, you know, in this family, we are fans of this team, and in some way, in a small way, I think, that influences how we view the world and how we act, right? But let's think of bigger and larger terms. What about stories that reflect our religious views, or our ethnicity, or our citizenship? Now, these are bigger ideas, right? But they also, and a lot of times, include histories or stories that we pass down from one generation to the next. And these stories, whether we like it or not, influence how we act, how we view the world. You know, an easy example of this is, so I grew up in Canada. My wife, however, grew up in Miami, Florida. Now, we come and we view the world in two very different ways. But when I see this, or one of the first times I saw this was when we traveled overseas. Now, I'm sure that many of you have had the opportunity to travel overseas. And if not, I'm sure many of you have had the opportunity to travel regionally within the States. How have you ever noticed that when you travel somewhere new, you view that place from where you're from? So it's interesting. So you may be American first and Texan second, but when you go and visit Denver, suddenly you're Texan, right? In that place. And that you view the world from that perspective. When me and my wife travel overseas, I travel as a Canadian. She travels as an American, And that has not only influenced how we act and behave, but it has also influenced how other people perceive us, right? And so stories create identity. Now, with that in mind, I want you to listen to these opening first four verses of the psalm. My people hear my teaching. Listen to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth with a parable. I will utter hidden things, things from of old, things we have heard and known, things our ancestors have told us. We will not hide them from our descendants. We will tell the next generation. And if there's one thing that I want you to come away with this morning, it is simply this, that we tell the next generation of God's faithfulness. And we do this because that faithfulness, the faithfulness of God, supplies our faithfulness to God. And the psalmist, I believe, knew this. Now, this call of the psalmist to tell the next generation was deeply rooted in the history of Israel, right? Time and time again, the Lord reminds his people, I have given you Torah, I have given you the law, I have given you this teaching. Your responsibility is to pass it down, right? To pass it down to your children and their children to their children, right? Think about Deuteronomy 6, verse 4 to 9. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your forehead. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. And so this command to tell the next generation of God's faithfulness was deeply rooted in the history of Israel. Now, if we look at verses 4 through 8, we see what is it that the psalmist requires of the next generation? What should we be telling the next generation? And this is what it says. It says, we will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power, and the wonders he has done. He decreed statutes for Jacob and established the law in Israel, which he commanded our ancestors to teach their children. So the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born. And why? See, the psalmist not only gives us what to do, but he tells us why to do it. And I have kids who are just, thank the Lord, moving out of this stage of, and now how many of you have had the toddler stage where it is why, the why question, right? The why, dad, son, you listen, you have to put your seatbelt on. Well, why, dad? Why? You know, and seemingly the craziest situations, it doesn't really matter what I'm asking my child to do. Why? Well, I'm very thankful. And if my children were here, I could tell them, listen, the psalmist has you covered, Dale, Matthew, and Grace. The psalmist has you covered. He tells us not only what to do, that is, tell the next generation, but he tells us why to do it. And we read why in verse 6. And the psalmist says, so the next generation would know them. And verse 7. Then they would put their trust in God and would not forget his deeds, but would keep his commands. Now, what is the psalmist saying here? I think the psalmist is saying remembrance leads to obedience. Hear that? Remembrance of God's commands, of God's faithfulness to us leads to obedience. And so the psalmist is saying, we tell the next generation about the faithfulness of God because the psalmist knows that by telling of God's faithfulness, it will inspire their children's faithfulness to God. Now, over the rest of the psalms, the next 64 verses, which we will not read all of it, but over the next 64 verses, I know you're thinking, yes, the psalmist is going to recount the faithfulness of God to Israel. And so, actually, I love this because this is a great example of great teaching, right? The psalmist is saying, tell the next generation. And then what the psalmist does is tell. the next generation. And so I want to just read a few of the key passages of this rehearsal of God's faithfulness to the nation of Israel. And as we do, I want us to see one thing, that this history of God's faithfulness has milestones. Now, one of the things I love to do when I'm asked to preach at a church is to listen to a previous sermon. And so I know a couple of weeks ago, Dr. Hill, Pastor Brian, speaked about milestones, right? Milestones in our walk, in our path of discipleship. There are key moments that we can remember. And I think that that is a great truth. And as we look at this history of Israel, there are also milestones that the people of Israel could look back on and say, this happened, it was something key, it was something monumental. And the climactic revelation of God for the people of Israel was the Exodus, right? God's radical deliverance of his people from bondage. And so we will look at, for example, in Psalm 78 now, at verses 13. This is what the psalmist said. He said, he divided, that is, God divided the sea and led them through. He made the water stand up like a wall. He guided them with the cloud by day and with light from the fire all night. He split the rocks in the wilderness and gave them water as abundant as the sea. Turn now to verse 41. Again and again, they put God to the test. They vexed the Holy One of Israel. They did not remember his power, the day he redeemed them from the oppressor, the day he displayed his signs in Egypt, his wonders in the region of Zoan. He turned their river into blood. They could not drink from their streams. He sent swarms of flies that devoured them and frogs that devastated them. He gave their crops to the grasshopper, their produce to the locust. He destroyed their vines with hail and their sycamore figs with sleet. He gave over their cattle to the hail, their livestock to bolts of lightning. He unleashed against them his hot anger, his wrath, indignation, and hostility, a band of destroying angels. He prepared a path for his anger. He did not spare them from death, but gave them over to the plague. He struck down all the firstborn of Egypt, the firstfruits of mankind and the tents of Ham. But he brought his people out like a flock. He led them like sheep through the wilderness. He guided them safely, so they were unafraid. But the sea engulfed their enemies. So he brought them to the border of his holy land, to the hill country his right hand had taken. He drove out nations before them and allotted their lands to them as an inheritance. He settled the tribes of Israel in their homes. So what we see in Psalm 78 is a call to the people of God. First, a call to Israel, but because of God's promise to Abraham to bless the nation, this is a call that we as the church receive as well. A call to remember and to tell the next generation. But at the heart of this command and at the heart of this psalm, we see this contrast. We see a contrast between the faithfulness of God and the faithfulness of his people. You see, despite his people's faithlessness, God remained faithful in blessing and in judgment. But this, I think, raises an important question that we need to ask. And it's a question that I think the text itself raises. Why are we to think that because God was faithful, he will continue to be faithful? You see, the entire psalm is predicated on this idea that God acted in a certain way. And because God acted in a certain way, he will continue to act in that same way. Why is this the case, though? The psalm, I think, gives us some clues. But in briefest terms, we can say this. God acts faithfully because of who he is. And in fact, I would define God's faithfulness as a perfect accord between his nature and his acts. A harmony between who God is and what God does. I think that can seem a little bit abstract, and it is, but let's bring it home literally. So, how many in here have pet homes? Homes that pets, you know, are not necessarily children, but almost children, and other homes where pets are pets. I'm sure a lot of people have pets. And when you are, yes, thank you, pets. Not me. Okay, great. Grew up with pets. We don't have pets right now. We have children. But one of the things that when you're making a decision to get a pet, what is one of the things that you're deciding on? A lot of times it's you're picking, let's say, a breed of dog, and you're saying, I want this type of dog because it's going to act in this sort of way, right? Maybe you have kids at home. You say, I want this type of dog because I know that it has a gentle spirit. It has maybe in past times it did this sort of activities, and so it'll be great to have at home. So what you're doing there is you're making a decision based on the character of the dog or the nature of the dog, right? So nature of the dog is going to dictate how that dog acts, of course. So right, nature, action, right? There's a connect there, there's a link there. But, and this is key, in pets and in humans, as we know, our nature and the way we act does not always accord. Is that right? And anybody who has a dog say, yes, I mean, I bought this dog for this reason, and unfortunately, the nature of the dog proved not to determine its actions quite enough, right? But the truth of the psalm is that with God, his nature and his actions are entirely in harmony. And so I mentioned earlier that the psalm draws on this climactic revelation of God, the Exodus. And now, with that in mind, I think there's another clue this psalm gives us that can help us dig deeper into this deep truth that the faithful God is faithful, was faithful, and will be faithful, right? Look at verse 4 in the psalm. It says, we will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord. Now, in your translation, that word Lord is capitalized, right? Fully, all caps. See, our English translations distinguish between two Old Testament Hebrew names of God, both translated Lord, but one is fully capitalized and the other has a capital just at the beginning. Now, this term Lord in all caps is the name for God's, it's God's proper name or personal name. We often say Yahweh. Now, I think that we can be helped as we try to understand this passage if we go back to Exodus where God reveals himself with this proper name. So if you would, turn with me to Exodus 3. We're going to start reading at verse 7. Now this is, of course, the context is God calling Moses to go to Egypt to deliver the people of God. And as we read this text, I want you to listen to the way that Moses asks God, questions God. I think we gain so much from the questions that the people of God ask. And so starting in verse 7, the Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I've heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I've come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey. Verse 9, and now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I've seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go, I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you. Notice that Moses asks the question, who am I? And God's response is the better question, who is God? Right. So God says, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. Nature, I am who acts I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name you shall call me from generation to generation. How is God to be remembered? The psalm says God is to be remembered by his faithfulness. And God tells Moses, I am to be remembered by this name, the I am who I am. And so we as the people of God are called to tell the next generation who God is, the I am, the one who was faithful, is faithful, and will be faithful. So this name, of course, I am who I am, controversial. There's lots of different interpretations. But one of the things that we know from this psalm, from the context, is God is saying to Moses, when Moses is saying, God, how can I go? Who am I that I can go to Egypt? And God's response, and I think that God so often tells us this, it's not about who you are. It's about who your God is. Right? So that song we sang this morning, yet not I, but Christ through me. The beautiful thing about that psalm is that it is us, right? And yet it's not. It's that moment at which we depend entirely upon God, and God works through us. And so this is the name that God will be remembered by. The I am who I am. And we know that this name is telling us about God's faithfulness. We know that it's telling about God's faithfulness. Why? Because that is what the entire story here is predicated on. It's all predicated on God being who he is. And God is saying to Moses, you know that I was faithful then. And I will be faithful. I will be with you. I am who I am. And this is to give Moses confidence. And so when we look at our psalm and we ask, and we see, well, yes, God, you were faithful. How do we know that you will be faithful? The answer the scriptures give us is that he is who he is. God is who he was, who he is, and who he will be. This complete faithfulness between who God is and what he does. Now, if we had time, we could look at the Gospels, right? We could look at how Jesus, the perfect revelation of God, picks up this theme of the I am who I am, right? So you think about in the Gospel of John, Jesus is being questioned by the Jews because Jesus is telling them, look, if you believe in me, you will not taste death. And for the Jews, this was blasphemous, see? For Jesus to say that, he was exalting himself above Abraham, the prophet. And in John 5:58, Jesus responds to this questioning. And Jesus says, very truly I tell you, before Abraham was born, I am. And for us, we may not see this, but can you hear that echo? I am. Jesus is saying that the same God who was faithful to the Israelites, to the nation, that same God who delivered you from bondage has now come in your midst in the person of Jesus Christ. What a striking statement. I am. Grammatically makes little sense, right? But his point is simply that Yahweh is here. Okay. That's a sermon for another day. All right. So, this leads us to ask the question, if this is this call on our lives to tell the next generation who God is, to tell the generation of God's faithfulness, What are we to do? Two things. And here I want to bring it back to what I started with it, which is that truth that stories create identity. The first thing I want to say is that I think we have to be really critical about the stories or the histories that we listen to that form us. What do I mean by that? Well, I said earlier that I have three young kids, right? And I wish the world for them. I pray that as they grow up, they would be so confident in God's faithfulness towards them, that they would be so sure of God's love for them. But you know what? In the day-to-day, in the mundane, in waking up at 6 or feeding breakfast, getting them to school, all of those things, how easy is it for me to be distracted? Not only distracted, but how easy is it for me to allow for other visions of what it means to live the good life for these children to take over? I mean, there's when it comes to raising kids, when it comes to parenting, there is so many competing stories, right? So many competing views of reality that say, this is what it would mean for your child to be successful. This is what it would mean for them to have a good life. And I want to say something, that these stories, these lies, they don't shout, hey. They whisper. Right? What I mean that it's not often the fact that I will consciously say to myself, you know what? I think that faith for my child would be great, but I really like him to play center for them in Winnipeg Jets. All right. Okay, that was a hockey reference. Do we have any hockey fans out here? One. Yes. Okay, here's the deal, is if you have me back in a year or two, I promise that all of the hockey references will be swapped out for baseball or football, okay? That's a promise. But for the time. So how easy it is for us, for the people closest to us, for us to know, you know, what I want for this person most of all is that they would have faith in Jesus Christ, and yet the world has so many competing stories that they are going to push on us, and slowly but surely, our main view of reality, instead of being rooted in the history of God's faithfulness to us, can get crowded out. So that's first, that's the first thing we need to do. We need to be so careful. But secondly, I think that we need to be proactive about grounding and rooting ourselves in the history of God with us. Proactive, right? Because I believe that this command to tell the next generation who God is can be applied to every single sphere of life. I look at, for example, our churches. This church, you know, I'll just say that it was such an honor to be asked to be with you this morning. A church that has a deep history in the city of Corpus Christi. A church that can say that we have praised God and worshiped God here on this ground for decades, right? And it was a bonus that since I live on the campus of Stark College and Seminary, I only had to make 2 turns because I'm still learning my way around the city, so I will say that was great, you know? Get on Ocean Drive and head on down. But I believe that we can follow this commandment in our churches and say, look, what are the milestones of this church, of this congregation, and be intentional about reminding ourselves of God's faithfulness, right? Of picking up those milestones. Same with our families. What are the milestones in our families closest to home that we could say, let's remember this. Let's intentionally remember God's faithfulness in this person's life. Because I believe that those proactive decisions will help us to not only remind ourselves, but to remind our children and our children's children. And I'll close with this. There's one thing. you can remember this morning. It's that God's faithfulness supplies your faithfulness to God. You know, every one of us will have ups and downs. We all have seasons in which following God seems easier than other times. Maybe you're in one right now. Every single morning is difficult. God's message to you is that despite that, despite your faithlessness, he's faithful to you. And that his faithfulness to you has never depended upon your faithfulness to him. And I need that. Oftentimes, I need that message. I need to know that truth. Let's pray. Jesus, I just thank you. I thank you, God, that when we are dead in our sins and transgressions, you came and you died for us, for me, Lord. I pray that this truth of your faithfulness to us would radically change every part of our lives, God. Would you right now help us to see areas in which we can apply this truth, God? Because as your people, we wish to be faithful to you, the Lord above all. The I am who I am. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Would you stand with us this morning? If you have a decision that you need to make this morning, or if you'd just like to come and pray, this is the time this morning as we sing together Beneath the Cross of Jesus.